The following views presented in this hour do not reflect the views of KDVS, KDVS sponsors, or the University of California. Good afternoon. My name is Francisco Dominguez. We have a great interview with Maestro Rudy Acuna this afternoon. We're going to play some music, and we'll be right back with the interview. Stay tuned. Rudy, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Oh, thank you. For the listeners, we have Professor Rudy Acuna on the line calling in from Los Angeles. And Rudy Acuna is a professor emeriti at CSU Northridge. He's also a scholar of Chicano history and an interesting, very interesting professor and activist. He's also the author of Occupied America. It's a classic in Chicano literature and history, and it's a history of Chicanos. Welcome to Radio Informar, Rudy. How are you doing?
Oh, fairly good. I have, please excuse me if I sometimes stumble a little bit, but I have Parkinson's, and I'm getting better, but still it slows you down.
Okay, Rudy. Well, you know, like I said, I thank you very much for coming onto the show, and whatever, you know, however I can help you or whatever, you know, we'll get through the interview just fine. Yeah.
Sure. Thank you.
Rudy, for the listeners, you know, I always am trying to educate with my show and especially educate young people. And could you tell the listeners how you became a, you know, from a young person, how you came to be a college professor, and not only that, but an activist?
Well, first of all, it was almost an accident. I came back from the Army, and so I started, you know, I had had 2 years of college, but then I went to Cal State LA, and then I started to listen to people, and I became a teacher, secondary teacher, for about 8 years, and then I, at the same time, worked for my doctorate, and I started teaching at community college, and I taught in a state university, and so on. You know, you become an activist when you see what's happening in the schools, and you see the difference between how different students are treated. You know, and you start to then to identify with the problems that many of the students are going through because you went through sometimes similar problems.
Yes, and you said you were in the Army, so you were in during the Korean War?
During the Korean War, I had an urge, and I went and I volunteered draft, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And 30 days after I volunteered draft, they signed the armistice. And then I was kind of sorry that I did, you know. And but I served 2 years. I got sent to Europe, where they were having trouble with Trieste at that time.
Mm-hmm.
And so I served there in Germany. And then I came back, and then is when I started my education.
Yes.
Because, well, not started. I had been in 2 years into it.
Yes. You know, I'm always interested in the Korean War. My father fought in Korea, and my father came to the United States on the Bracero program, and he wanted to stay in the United States, so he looked around to see how he could stay, and then someone told him, well, you go join the Army, and they'll give you your citizenship when you come back. And that's how my father became a citizen, yes, here in this country. But Rudy, you know, you said that you started to look around. You were looking around at what the problems were, and what are the are things different? What's the difference of the problems the problems of today? The problems of when you were looking around.
Well, at that time, you know, I went to LA State. It used to cost me $10 a semester for fees, you know, and that was it. And then you could buy a big cup of coffee and a cinnamon roll for a buck. Today, the students can't afford to buy a cup of coffee at the school. they don't have the money. Today, the tuition runs many times that runs in over $500 a semester, and it's rising. If you want to go to graduate school, I mean, at one time you could it would cost you a couple hundred bucks to go to law school at UCLA. Today, it's an awful lot more. And so consequently, it's just the cost. Also, the schools today are, a lot of them are neoliberal universities. They're privatized. And so that is another barrier for students.
Yes, Rudy, could you, for the listeners, could you give a definition of what neoliberalism is?
Well, neoliberalism is rooted in the concept that the elite, the best in society, can run a public institution, and even if they make money from it. So in that way, they privatize it. At CSUN, you have, for example, you have a shadow university that controls the main university. They use state property. They use buildings built by the student, but a private company and makes money from it.
Right.
The students have built all of the buildings. For the last 10 years, every building has been built with student funds.
Yes.
The students never get an accounting. The tuition goes up and up. And just like everything else, you have more and more bureaucrats. You have assistants to a vice president. Then you have an associate to the vice president. So you have about 9 different
positions.
Administrators. Rudy, somebody has to pay for that.
Rudy, so you see the main difference of when you were looking at things. This was probably, 60 years ago, 50 years ago?
This was about 1955, you know.
Okay, so that's probably the main impediment for students of color now to go to college is the cost.
Is the cost, yes.
Whereas
the cost, and before I got my Parkinson's, I noticed about a third of my students used to come to class without any food. They hadn't eaten. And you had homelessness among the students that had grown, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And so consequently, how can a student who hasn't taken a shower in the morning, hasn't eaten breakfast, feel comfortable taking a class? So I think the students are much more exploited today than they were when I was going in. First of all, the generation were different. When you come from a GI generation, you come in with a certain concept that you have rights, you know? The students today don't have any rights, and they've been just bulldozed over.
Right, and so you're saying they're not taught their rights, or they just don't have a concept of rights?
No, they just don't have rights. You see, right now, since the Reagan years, we've had Reagan, we've had his chancellors, we've had everybody who have shifted all of the cost of education to the students.
Right.
And you know, with that has been the concept. Well, if we give them, we make them work for it, they'll earn it, and they'll be too tired to demonstrate.
Yes, I remember when I was a student, I had a class with Professor Jack Forbes here at UC Davis. It was an anthropology class, and one day we were having coffee. And then he mentioned Ronald Reagan, and he said, "Francisco, you haven't seen nothing yet." And at that time, I didn't really know what he was talking about, you know?
Well, even today, let's say, for example, some people are trying to make patriots out of those people on January 6th. There were a bunch of thugs. There were people without any kinds of values. They weren't patriots that make America great. I mean, I laugh at that because they couldn't have made anybody great. I mean, you throw them in. What are they going to invent? You see.
Right, and then the latest in the news, it's coming out that a lot of policemen were there, you know. Politicians were there. It's interesting though, because at the beginning they just said, "Oh, they're radicals, right wing radicals." But they knew who was there because they have all the videos. But now, several months later, now they're coming out with all the police that were there, an ex-military.
They're a bunch of incompetents. They're afraid. The ones that don't think it's right, they're afraid to say anything because they'll have to get a job. These people that never worked a day in their life. One thing about our family, you know, everybody worked. My grandfather, my uncles, they worked for the SP. My father worked over there for the Western Costume. People worked, and you expected to work. Today, they don't work, you see. And they begrudge everybody else. And then they know inherently. Did you say watch that little 12-year-old girl among the black community that was introduced during before the Biden administration? She was a poet laureate.
Right.
She was superior to any of those idiots that were out there saying, he says, it belongs to us. It doesn't belong to them. Never did.
No,
lynching was as American as public as apple pie.
Yes, and you know,
it, you know, and if you think that the lynchers are good, there's something wrong with you.
Yeah, that was good. We have a lot of young, talented people. You know, very
talented
people.
Talented people.
You know,
but what concerns me are idiots among us who are Hispanics or Latinos or Chicanos for Trump. You know, I mean, how stupid can you be to vote against your own class interest?
Yeah, that's a real dilemma there, you know?
It's a dilemma. It's only a dilemma because we let it be a dilemma. Like the people on January 6th, we should just charge them with violation of the 14th Amendment and classify them as traitors and put them in jail.
No, I agree. You know, and it's interesting too, because if it was people of color trying to storm the Capitol, breaking windows, kicking in doors, can you imagine? You know, a couple thousand black people trying to take over the Capitol, or a couple thousand Chicanos trying to take over, or Native Americans trying to take over the Capitol? What would have happened to them?
Oh, you remember when the Black Panthers came over there, and they were armed?
Yes.
Everybody was panicking that they were taking over the Sacramento.
Yes, at the Capitol.
I mean, but that is so stupid. If it was a Mexican or it was a black or it was any other group, they would have already put them in jail.
Yes.
These people here are running wild, you know. I remember when they used to say that the Chicanos had an Air Force because you had the Royal Chicano Air Force up there. And, I mean, it was a joke.
Right.
Because that's what it was meant to be. And these people were making a big thing that the Chicanos had an Air Force.
Yeah, no, there's a total double standard within our laws of what people can do with white privilege. And have the law back them up, you know. We've seen it's very clear now, you know. And Rudy,
all about race.
Yes,
losing it. They can take all of the Viagra that they want, and they're still going to be losing.
Yeah, Rudy, I was going to ask you about the current situation with immigration, And we have a new administration now with Biden and Harris. You know, Harris just came back from Guatemala, and that's an interesting one too, because, you know, the people that are coming from Guatemala are Native Americans. You know, I've been to Guatemala. They have like majority full-blooded Native Americans there. They have a beautiful culture, and they can't make it economically, so they're coming, you know, to come here to work. They're not coming here to hang out, you know.
Well, and especially since we created the conditions, when they used to have the drug trade that used to be coming from Colombia to the United States carrying the white stuff, they had their, you know, they could stop the ships, et cetera. But what did they do? They put down the trail, they put it right down Middle America. So consequently, what does this do? It creates the cartels.
Yes.
So the cartels are American-made. And they're the ones that create, they buy the arms, they buy those big BARs, et cetera.
Yeah.
Hey, the United States is making the profit. Even Bill Clinton one time apologized. He says that the problems that Mexico has are made by the United States in the war on drugs. But here we have then people, let's close up that border.
Rudy, do you ever think that this country will ever have a reconciliation on race and what it's done throughout history to people of color?
The reconciliation is going to be is that the populations, the minority populations, are not going to stop growing. They're going to have more and more people. If we can keep everybody together and get those idiots for Trump among us out, we have a fairly good chance. But the minute that we capitulate with these people and we let them control the narrative, that is when we're up shit's creek.
Yes, and I was thinking more on the lines of what happened in South Africa with the reconciliation with Nelson Mandela, when Nelson Mandela said, we're not going to kick the white people out of the country, that we are one country, we have to come together. And,
yeah, but you name one instance where minorities have tried to kick out the whites. They haven't done it. So here it's a different situation than the situation in South Africa. You see, the South Africa, you had a chance because things were so polarized, and you had then a kind of sane population. You see, the people around Mandela were sane, and you had enough whites that were sane. I don't know if we have enough whites that are sane here. Not when you have 75% of Republicans being for the people on January 6th.
Yeah, or for Trump, you know?
Oh, yeah, for Trump. I mean, yeah. You know, you look at him, he's a rascal. All orange.
Mm-hmm.
They're all orange, and I think that you look at him and then... And then he can't even use the English language properly. And he's supposed to have gone to the best schools. And you look at him and he's drooling over his daughter.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a little bit too much, you know?
Yeah, this country has definitely shifted and definitely has a different profile in the eyes of people from all around the world after 4 years of Trump, and there's been a lot of damage done, you know.
I feel sorry for many of the Chicanos that I've been Trump. I mean, that is an idiocy, you know.
Yeah, I really don't, you know. I was going to ask, when I interviewed Jose Cuellar, you know, because uh-huh. he's from Texas, and you have a lot of Chicano Trumpers there, you know, but I didn't want to ask him. I should have went ahead and asked him how did what happened in Texas for it to get like that. But it's not just in Texas either. It's here, you know. It's in Sacramento. It's in Los Angeles. It's Arizona. There's a lot of Chicano people that have gone Republican Party, and I don't quite get it, you know, because like you said, to vote against
your in the early days of the movement. Very good friend of mine, very dark, tall, and he says, "I'm white. My birth certificate says so." You know, he was no more white than the man on the moon. Why the obsession? Because this is a caste system. You look back at colonialism, and you know, you got rewards for being white, or you had rewards for being just a shade darker than white, or two shades, darker than white. So you have to look at the economics. It pays. Those ranchers and the people that work along the border, they get tax breaks. So consequently, you know, they play the American game, greed.
So that's part of the assimilation process?
Well, it's not the assimilation process, but it's the process of human beings here. Now, who's the one that we have Tijuana, but who created Tijuana? It was American tourism, American taking their vices there to Tijuana. The same thing you have along the border.
Same thing in Juarez, you know?
Oh, yeah.
You cross the border in Juarez. There's a whole nightclub section that has a lot of bad things going on there, and that's to serve Fort Hood, the biggest army base in the country there in Texas.
Oh, yeah. You have it all along. And you have stupid people that think they're going to control the border. Well, first of all, control your corruption, you see?
Yes.
Because the United States is to blame for that. Who makes them? Was it Arizona? Who makes the money selling arms?
Yeah.
It's American interest here.
That was the other thing about Kamala Harris, you know, when she went to Guatemala, she said she wasn't going to go to Honduras or El Salvador because those countries are corrupt. And I'm like, excuse me? What about the corruption here? You know?
Oh, the corruption here is worse because we make the corruption over there. You see?
Yeah.
We make them over there. So let's not blame them for our, for our history.
You know, because after 4 years of Trump, they're going to be uncovering the corruption for the next 4 years.
Yeah, but we don't even have to look at the Trump years. Go back. Every group that's been in the United States, you see, starting with even the Germans, the Catholics, you have every group that has been, that their churches have been burned to the ground. They have been lynched. The Italian was lynched. The Chinese was lynched. Name a group that was not lynched. Now, who were lynching them? Good Americans. So you know, I like some of the things that Biden does, but I don't think that when he says this is not who we are, this is precisely who we are.
Yes. Yes, there's been atrocities after atrocities over the years, you know.
Yeah, look at right now. One of the things, reasons I got in it, when I looked at what was happening in Yemen, looking at what is happening in the Middle East, where Israel was denying the vaccine
to the Palestinians.
To the Palestinians.
Yeah.
I mean, is this humanity?
Yeah, I was talking to a friend a few weeks ago, and he was telling me what a great president Abraham Lincoln was, you know.
Abraham Lincoln had his hang-ups.
Exactly. Then I told him, you know, Abraham Lincoln, he ordered a mass hanging of Native Americans, 400, you know, a mass, 400 at once. He said they all got to die, you know. And then he started getting criticized, so he only hung 38 all at once. They built gallows, 38 in Minnesota. and hung them on. And then my friend said, he did more good than bad.
No, he did not.
I said, okay. I said, go do some research on that and then come back and talk to me, you know. Because
You know, one of the reasons I've gotten more trouble is because I said that the United States invaded Mexico. Well, they did. I have a new, I'm remaking the last cover of my last book, and I'm going to put it there. It says Jack Forbes' book. He says America invaded Europe. Yeah, we're the ones that invaded them. How do we know that they invaded us or something?
Right.
I mean, it's stupid.
Yeah.
Let's say, for example, if I put in $1 million for research on a topic, and you put in $5, who's going to get the majority of documents and books out?
Yes.
And so the United States controls this.
Rudy, we're coming down to the half an hour mark, you know, I didn't want to keep you on for too long. And I always ask my guests, do they have a message for the listeners? You know, do they have a message for the young students, for the people listening, a message for hope, you know, for our future, what people can do to organize, to make our society better, you know?
Well, one of the things is, you know, as I said, I have Parkinson's. And,
Yes. You
know, at one time I was down. I couldn't even operate because of my wife, because of my daughter, because of medication. You know, I'm coming back. So I think that you should look after the older people. And if you see that something is wrong, you should help them, not try to steal from them. How many phone calls do we get about Social Security, trying to get our Social Security number? I think that's wrong.
Yes.
And I think that it's also wrong for us just not to look at our society and to see that everybody is healthy, everybody has something to eat, that we are our brothers and our sisters' keeper. And I'm not religious at all, but I do believe in that. And I think that this is what we have to do. And we have to also be very demanding of government. We have to demand that it be just. And so this is just my message, is that, and the last thing is, we have to speak out. You know, if something is wrong, say it's wrong. Don't be afraid. I'm not afraid of the idiots. You know, I'm 89. What are they going to do, shoot me? Hey, you know, they're going to make you a martyr. Then you're more of a problem than when you were living. So, consequently, let's speak out. Let's speak out for our communities. Let's speak out for our neighbors. Let's speak out for the Middle Easterns, to the Africans, and the people here. This is what we have to do.
Rudy, I want to thank you very much for coming on Radio Informar. I want to thank your wife, Guadalupe, for helping set this up also. And
well, here's her saying goodbye. Oh, she doesn't want to.
Okay.
Hello?
Yes.
Okay. So, but say hello to Jose if you see him.
I'll call him and I'll tell him, Rudy. Thank you very much. And I wish you all the best and for your family also, for all the best, all right. For all the good things.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.
Bye.